I put my notes on my phone. I didn't have a chance to switch them over to anything else, so bear with me. One of my favorite things about Allie was her ability to pick out clothes for people. She would call me all excited saying, "Hey, I just got this amazing dress for you," or for one of her other friends. And we always loved what she got. It didn't matter what it was. She just had such a great eye for that. We always had so much fun playing dress up, even at 20, you know, plus years old. And she helped me to realize that just getting dressed every day could be something fun. You could make it fun, and that just turns your entire day into an event. And I'll always carry that with me.
Allie was one of my longest and closest friends. I've known her about 15 years from elementary school. And as long as I knew her, she had one of the biggest hearts that I've ever known, of anyone that I've ever known. She was full of life, full of love for others, and most importantly, Jesus. She was completely selfless, inspiring, and just a beautiful person. Allie, I'm so happy that you are pain-free and you're dancing at the feet of Jesus right now. I will miss you immensely until I can see you again. But I thank God for the friendship that he gave me with you. And I love you forever. Terry, I love you. Appreciate your friendship too. And the Chambers, thank you.
I wrote mine kind of like a letter. Dear Allie, you are one of the most beautiful people I've known inside and out. You strove to bring out the best in others, and in turn made others feel beautiful as well. You often saw potential in people and situations before everybody else did. Maybe that's the reason why you were so creative. You never hesitated to express affection. You never gave up on your dreams. When I think about you, I don't want to be sad, because our time together deserves to be remembered happily. I love you, Allie, and I know I'll see you someday.
I have a book here. my name is Aisha. Allie and I have worked together for the past 3.5 years since I moved to Nashville. And I'm going to begin by saying I'm not a public speaker, but obviously I have a lot to say about Allie. Not only am I wearing a rainbow and pot of gold that she made, I put my big girl panties on so I could do this for her. I decided that the best way to memorialize Allie would be to list in detail her favorite foods. So I'll start at the top 100 and work my way back. Number 100. The Fat Mo's Chicken Deluxe Sandwich. If you've been to Fat Mo's and had it, you know what I mean. Number 99, Duncan Hines chocolate icing in a can to be eaten with a spoon. Number 98, Chicks, Ducks, and Bunnies. The sweet tarts you can only find at Easter, and Allie would hoard so she could have some through the year. Number 96, a Dairy Queen Blizzard. With two toppings, always two. She did love the sugar. Allie was a foodie, but that's not really the point of any of this. What you may expect is to be regaled with stories and phrases of things that Allie said or did. But what I want to share with you is the essence of what I came to know and loved about Allie. Most of you probably knew her, but many of you may not have known her in quite the way that I did and what it was like to work with her. My work, my art, has become more important to me since I moved to Nashville, and therefore that's how I came to know Allie, and her role initially began and then became so crucial in my life. While I know her work outside of my shop was brilliant and varied, inside my shop is what I know best, and Allie was amazingly talented. She may not have been early, but she always showed up and stayed late. She was my support, my team, and we complemented each other perfectly. You may not have known, but she didn't always want to make the decisions and have the responsibility in the technical side of sewing, which I did. However, she was very smart and would often figure out clever solutions and prettier ways to do things to complete the projects that we worked on together. She was great at the details, I guess. I was the big picture person. She allowed me to jump into projects, confident in knowing she had my back, because we were a great team. I greatly respected that Allie was responsible and trustworthy and steadfast and steady and dependable and was entertaining because she was always full of random non sequiturs and the best, most graphic food descriptions ever. Made me want to become a foodie my own self. We'd be working and all of a sudden she'd bust out with some completely random thought or phrase or idea or meal or conversation she'd had. It was funny and always caused a what reaction. But she was good for a laugh. Since I first moved to Nashville and called the Tennessee rep looking for overhire suggestion, Allie has been my girl. While she's not the only person I hired, she definitely became one of the few I trusted completely. She became another part of me. She understood my language. She and I worked together so much, and we fit so well, that she knew what I was saying even when I didn't know, or said the complete opposite of what I meant. Many of the projects we were given required us to both grow in knowledge and skill, and she always rose to that challenge. She was continually improving and learning, which was something, sometimes with a sigh, but in the end was with eagerness to accomplish the project. She always understood what the job needed and did it, or learned how and tackled it beautifully. Funny note, I always thought it interesting that while sewing, she crowded herself in. Most people would want the area on the machine to be clear so they could do their work, and she would pile it up anyway and just sew. In fact, she couldn't sew if it wasn't piled up. With all the things I've done since I moved here, I couldn't do much of it without her, and I was made better because of her. She was my cornerstone, the one that held me up to do what had to be done in my own life, and I hope I did the same for her. It's weird to me now, which is something I'm not proud of, but I didn't always see her. It seems I've had my head down and focused on my work, but I always felt her presence when she was there and because she was in my life and because she enriched me so much. We worked off each other's energy. We were shoulder to shoulder, and she held me up as I held her. I needed her, and I think she needed me as well. We meant a lot to each other in the day-to-day. It was as though she was my work wife. We depended on each other, put up with each other, and loved each other. Terry, thank you for sharing her with me. Seriously, though, we worked alongside each other. We carried the burden of what needed to be done together, and I tried to help her as much as she helped me. I'm only beginning to realize how heavily I relied on her, not only for her skills, but for her friendship. Because of our bond, I had grown fiercely loyal for her, as I do for those I love, and would have fought for her and protected her in any way I could. As in any good production, everyone plays their part. With me and Allie, hers in my life was a supporting role to a supporting role to a supporting role, but it was crucial nonetheless, the one that held up the entire operation. And I appreciated her, much like John described, that someone who works together should. In a weird way, as for the work, I didn't know where I stopped and Allie began, because I relied so heavily on her. We definitely had a symbiotic relationship, truly a relationship between two people in which each person is dependent upon and receives reinforcement from the other. In this case, it was very beneficial, I believe, to both of us. Her talents and skills and loves far outreached mine, and yet she stuck with me, and I thank her for that. The way things were set up seemed to work well for her, too. They allowed her to come in late, and it allowed her to pursue her other loves, photography and graphic design and ice skating in one of the few times available to the public, midday. She had such a broad range of skills. I was often amazed by her creativity and ideas and interests. She didn't just like those things. She was good at them. I was always amazed at how broad her talent was, and not only that, but how her creativity and talent spurred her on to make so many beautiful, interesting things. I actually didn't expect us to be friends, an unlikely pair, I think. With her love of princesses and musicals and Hannah Montana, and my realism and dirty mouth and wicked mind and what she calls no shame. But she put up with me and proved to be one of my dearest friends. I was proud of her for always striving to keep working at things in her life, her marriage, her art, and even the things she enjoyed. Her creativity knew no bounds. All she wanted to do, other than create, was to travel. We had both been to New Zealand and had discussed going back together someday. Thank you to her parents for raising such a special child that grew into such a special lady. I have truly been so blessed to know her and work beside her for the past 3 years. In fact, I've spent more time with her than anyone since I moved to this city. And I am so grateful that she stuck with me through all the crazy, not just work, but moves and changes and floods, oh my. She actually helped save the shop in my basement when all the flooding happened last spring. She bailed sewer water for 5 hours and saved the bottom half of my house. My life has been enriched. We enjoyed each other's company. I guess it's true when they say that the good die young. Let me tell you, she was a good one. So I guess she had to go. If that's the case, I'm going to live forever. She was a great example to me with her patience and her Christian ways and her love for people. She never cursed and was often appalled, though she wouldn't let it show, at things I had to say, and yet, I hope, was entertained by me. She loved her family, her husband, and all her Christians. I mean friends, as well as her church. She loved you all so much and had so much fun with each of you. She only said good things and was truly an example of how to be a good person. In fact, I may know more about you than you know about yourself from our conversations. Ultimately, the point is she made me better to be around her. It was a pleasure to know Allie for over 3 years that I knew her and to see her grow and mature and become her own woman and blossom. I think she greatly wanted approval in her life. And I want to say at this time, Allie, I approve. I approve of all that you did in your life and who you were. It was a life to be proud of. I relied on her so heavily, even in spirit, that I knew we would work together forever. I had envisioned working with her when we both had children that we brought into the shop, and as the business grew and as we grew older, and only expected our friendship to grow deeper. I truly thought we would be lifelong friends. I was blessed to know her and work side by side with her. I was lucky to call her my friend. Her loss will be felt the rest of my days. My main comfort is knowing that we all have a new guardian angel. And if those words of mine aren't enough to convince you, here are a few more from one of our clients, Miss Dolly Parton. She sent this fax in today to be read at her memorial. Dearest Allie, you know some of the most beautiful dresses I have were made with your loving hands. Even when no one wanted to sew all those rhinestones onto the clothes, you would. All because we were kindred souls. We both love sparkle and shine. The more, the better has always been our motto. I like to think that your love of sparkly things came from deep inside you. It reflected the joy, spirit, and life that ignited your heart. I also like to think that now you are shining and sparkling with the angels in heaven where you belong. Do me a favor, Allie. Smile down on us and remind us that you're healthy now, dancing in heaven, and know that you are deeply missed by us all. I will always love you, Dolly.
I'm Karen Sykes, for those of you who don't know me, and this is a Northeast women's softball team. You heard a lot of great stories tonight about one great person, and that she was a great daughter, a great sister, a great wife. To us, she was a great teammate. Some of you might not have known that Allie became an athlete when she stepped on the field. She became competitive. She played behind me. I play first. Allie was my backup. I'd say, be ready, Allie. They're coming our way. Okay, I'm going to try. Whenever she stepped on the field or she stepped in the batter's box, Allie gave it her all. We're going to miss number 39. But as of tonight, as we all move forward, we're going to retire that number 39 jersey with Northeast women's softball team. And it will forever live with us on our new jerseys, because Allie will always be in our heart and in our mind. And as we take the field and step in the batter's box, her spirit will be right there with us forever.
I've heard it said that people come into our lives for a reason, bringing something we must learn, and we are led to those who help us most grow if we let them, and we help them in return. Well, I don't know if I believe that's true, but I know I'm who I am today because I knew you. Like a comet pulled from orbit as it passes a sun, like a stream that meets a boulder halfway through the wood. Who can say if I've been changed for the better? But because I knew you, change for good. It well may be that we will never meet again in this lifetime. So let me say before we part, so much of me is made of what I learned from you. You on my heart, and now whatever way our stories end, I know you have rewritten mine by being my friend. Like a ship blown from its mooring by a wind off the sea, like a seed dropped by a sky bird in a distant world. I've been changed for the better, but because I knew you, because I knew you, I have been changed for good. And just to clear the air, I ask forgiveness for the things I've done you blame me for. But then I guess we know there's blame to share, and none of it seems to matter anymore. Like a comet pulled from orbit as it passes a by a wind off the sea, like a stream that meets a boulder halfway through the wood. Who can say
Hello, everybody. When I heard the news through Lena about Allie's passing, we were sitting there, and there was a lot of peace that just washed over me because I knew that she was whole and healthy again. And I started to smile, and I told Lena, and it just this thought came to my head, and I said, you know what would be awesome? I said, if everybody just dressed up to the hilt, to the nines, and, you know, big elaborate costumes for her celebration of life ceremony. And I really didn't think I would be standing here in a Jack Sparrow costume when I had that thought and didn't think it'd manifest itself in this way totally. But here I am. Just as Aisha said, I had to put on my big boy shorts, or my little boy shorts, as these little tight things. Yeah. Come right out here. And but the funny thing is it's all out. And that's just the way Allie did things. She pushed the envelope and went big and thought big. And she was a treasure to our children's ministry here at the church. As me and my wife, often we think big, and we're big kids, and Allie was right there with us in that. So often when we have our fall festivals, we could always count on Allie to have the most elaborate and the most awesome costume and get right in there with us. And it was just amazing. And also she was, this past year at the Fall Festival, we had a costume contest here at the church. And we judged people as they were coming through the doors. And they got here, and Allie came in just fashionably late, as she sometimes did. And she was in the back of the room as John was announcing the winners of the costume contest. And just like anybody, actually, just like nobody but Allie would do, she stood up right in the middle of the church and interrupted and said, "What about me?" In this beautiful snow white steampunk costume that she designed and made herself. And it was just typical Allie. It was so wonderful at the Fall Festival because we always had what we call scaryoke. And we could count on her for an awesome tune, always a big show tune of some sorts or something. And we also had a incredible mother-daughter tea, and Allie would always go, you want to share about that, sweetheart?
I'm just a little bit short, sorry. Hello, ladies. So we did a mother-daughter tea last year, and I wanted to name it the Mad Hatter tea that our women's ministry was going to do. So naturally, as Pastor John says, you always surround yourself with people that can do things better than you. So I called in for Allie's help, and Allie used to work at the Pampered Palace. And for those of you that have little girls, Pampered Palace is a place where you go and get your hair all made up pretty, and you wear razzle-dazzle dust and sparkles and those things. And so I called on Allie, and I said, I've got this idea. You know, I want to do a Mad Hatter tea, and, you know, the women's ministry want me to be Alice. And she said, well, I've got an Alice costume, but my Alice costume is different. And so I said, well, that's great. We can have two different kind of Alices and stuff. So she said, let me do little Alice's Corner, and we will do the girl's hair. And so she went home, and she made about 100 little hair pieces for these little girls that she was going to come and share with us. The flood ended up happening, so we didn't get to do that tea party. But moving forward, I would love to, with the women's ministry, maybe at our teas, always have a little corner that we call Allie's Corner for her. I just think that would be such a nice thing. Allie, like we were talking about, she loved to play dress up, and that's every child's dream, and that's what children love. And so she just had that amazing spirit about her. Towards the end of her life, I just began to pray, God, heal her body. Lord, do something miraculous. Lord, give us a miracle. And I felt the Lord say to me so tenderly, I did not design your bodies to live forever, but I did design your spirits too. And I believe that Allie's spirit is very much alive. And I believe every time we see a costume or have a Halloween party or do dress up anything, we will always remember Allie, and she will always be alive with us. Thank you.
I'd like to leave you from a little lyric from the last time she was here at our Fall Festival, and she did Don't Rain on My Parade. And I think it's very, very fitting. It says, don't tell me not to fly, I've simply got to. If someone takes a spill, it's me and not you. Who told you you're allowed to rain on my parade? I want us to celebrate Allie's life and smile, and it be a celebration. And mourning is totally part of the grieving process, but Allie right now, I know she's looking down at me in this costume right now with a big smile on her face, and it honors her for us to do those things. And I thank you for the opportunity to stand up here like this and share about the goodness that is Allie.
Hey, can I help you?
Hi, yeah.
Looking for a new religion?
Yeah, I'm just not...
Not sure which one's right for you.
That's it. There's, you know, thousands of rules, books to read, meetings to attend. It's all a little overwhelming.
Well, here at Progressive Religion, we have thousands of religions.
That's it. It's thousands of religions. I mean, I just don't know which one's right for me.
Well, we can analyze your life, pick a religion, and customize it so it's perfect for you.
Wow, you guys can do that?
We're the only ones that can. Just look what we did for this guy.
Wow.
Yeah, wow.
I want to be that guy.
I want to be that guy too. Except I'm not a guy. Yeah.
Yeah.
My name's J.D. Wiggins, and I'm the creative arts pastor here at Godwhy. I had the distinct pleasure and privilege of working with one of the most creative people I've ever known, in Allie. You saw her acting here. She came to me one day and said, I'm so excited. I said, you know Flo, and then the progressive girls. I said, yeah. She goes, can we do something with that? And I'm like, well, absolutely. If you have a passion to do it, there's no way we will not do it. Because I know that anything that she was passionate about, she poured herself into fully. She did a sketch with us one time with her sister Erica called... Christians Gone Wild, Those Crazy Corinthians. And it harkened back to the first century church and how they may have had dysfunction in their church, just like we had dysfunction in ours, and described some of the things that were going on in the Bible in modern day terms. And the humor and the light that she brought to that project will be forever remembered by anybody who ever saw it. We worked together on fabricating a jack-in-the-box head for one of the sketches that we did. And we contemplated buying one, and we decided that instead we would go ahead and make one. And there it is. I don't know how much it would have cost to buy one, but I do know that it took us about 12 hours just to do the papier-mâché on the large play ball, inflatable play ball. Hi, Jack. And we held our breaths as we punctured the ball after the papier-mâché dried, hoping that when it imploded, it didn't collapse all the papier-mâché. Well, it didn't, obviously, and we celebrated like a couple of kids when that happened, because we were so afraid that 12 hours of work was going to go down the drain, but it didn't, and it turned out beautifully. She took it home and finished the rest of it, and it has... Since that day, since the day that we use it, been proudly and prominently displayed in my office here, and will remain so for as long as I'm here. The last thing that I remember Allie doing here in the area of creative arts was a sketch with her father, where he played against type, a very harsh and unforgiving father. And Allie's response to his callousness was to sing the song, Cruel to Be Kind. And if you ever knew Allie to be cruel to anybody, I will give you whatever I have in my bank account. Because she was the kindest person, perhaps, that I've ever met. And she will be sorely missed. Sweetheart, would you like to say a few words about when you learned about who Allie was?
This is my wife, Tammy.
Yes, I would. I remember the first time I ever heard about Allie, then Allie Chambers. And I was in a speech class with Erica at Volunteer State Community College, and we'd been given an assignment to do a persuasive speech, and Erica decided to do hers on the specialness of Allie. And I remember she brought in these beautiful paintings that Allie had done, and I remember being amazed at how beautiful they were, and as she explained that she had never had an art class in her life. And it was apparent from my conversations with Erica and from her presentation that Allie was truly very creative and very special. And it was apparent of what a light she was to her family, to her friends, to our church, and to our world.
And in closing, I'd just like to say that for my part, having been able to share that light that Allie brought to everything that she did, I know that heaven has received a beautiful soul, and that every time I look up into the sky at night, I will believe that I see her light still shining up there, a brand new star in the heavens. We love you, Allie.
Have you ever wondered?
give you my heart, I give you my soul, I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm away. Lord, have your way in me. Lord, I give you my
I'm Allie's mom, May Chambers. I had to spend a minute back there catching Phil Keggy. Those of you who know Phil Keggy was back in the back just playing guitar. Humble man that he is, just wanting to celebrate this time with us and be here for us. I want to say thank you. I'm here to talk about Allie's faith. From the moment I knew I was carrying any of my children, I began to pray that God would keep them, that God would draw them to his heart, that they would be Jesus babies and Jesus children and Jesus adults. And Erica, no doubt, when she was there, can't even remember when Erica was saved. It was just, I don't know, maybe at 3 months. With Allie, it was a little more of a challenge. She had a little more of a, I don't know, as James Dobson puts it, a strong-willed child. I remember one time she was the sandbox, and you know, I noticed she'd been dumping sand out of the sandbox, and I went and saw her. She was getting ready to dump another whole bucket of sand, and I said, Allie, don't dump that in the grass. Put it back in the sandbox. And she just looked at me, and she just dumped it. That was my Allie. Some people called it spunk. I called it willful disobedience. Anyway, we beat that out of her. No, I'm just kidding. No, I read the book on willful disobedience, and anyway, we loved her through it. And I remember when she was little, well, growing up, even elementary school years, she would say, Mom, it's not fair. You spank me and you never spank Allie. Or Erica. She never spank Erica. And I said, well, Erica listens to us and does what we say. And you don't, so you get the spankings. And Erica told me later that she had a way of kind of hiding what she did. And Allie kept saying, I kept trying to tell you, Erica really wasn't as good as you thought she was. You know, I mean, parents were easily duped sometimes. But bottom line is, you know, all my kids know that as a mother and both of us, you know, father too, our greatest desire for our children is to love the Lord and to follow after the Lord with all their hearts. And whatever they do in life, I said, whatever you choose to do in life, if you want to play dress up for the rest of your life, hopefully you get paid for it, which she did, you know, that you'll do it to the glory of God, which she did. And she would tell me that she got saved on Easter Sunday after an Easter play at our church in Phoenix. She took a little friend with her, and they went up and made their profession of Christ. And that was always, she told me, that's when I got saved. That's when I got saved. She knew. And as she got older, she wanted to go on every mission trip she possibly could. She wanted to be changed. She wanted to be in God's presence. She began to love praise and worship music. She picked up the guitar and taught herself to play so she could play praise and worship music. She wanted to go to New Zealand and take a praise and worship school there. She was going to be gone for 6 months. And she raised money for a year to be able to go to New Zealand with Youth with a Mission, YWAM. She went on a DTS, which is Discipleship Training School. That was life-changing for her. And three of her friends that went on that New Zealand trip with her came to visit her 2 weeks before she died. One flew in from Atlanta, one flew in from Toronto, one flew in from Seattle. That's how bonded those kids were. And they just praised God while they were here. They had a little fun, too. I mean, praising God is fun, too. Amen. So And I wanted to tell you a little something, too, about Allie when she first met Terry. Hi, Terry, I'm going to tell on you. When she first met Terry, actually, I was doing a couple of things with the girls. You know, Allie, come and go swing dancing with us, or come go out and eat with me and my friends, you know, meet my friends. And I'm like, okay, you know. So I'm the only adult there, you know, that's okay. I want to meet her friends. And I noticed how Terry looked at Allie. And I said, well, what do you think of Allie? Or I asked Allie, what do you think of Terry? And Allie said, oh, he's just a friend. And I said, no, I think he's looking at you more like as a friend. You know, I think he's a little more interested in you than just a friend. And she began to really think about that and thought maybe he was serious about it. So she asked him about it. And he said, well, yeah, I'd like to take you out. And Allie was so bold. She said, you know, I see all your friends are Christians. They're studying to be youth pastors or ministers. But Terry, I never hear you talk about Jesus or go to church. I just need to know, Terry, are you a Christian? Bold, huh? And Terry just said, well, I never thought about it. I just like to hang around these guys. And Erica said, well, if you want to date me, you need to think about it. And they began to study the Bible together. And, you know, I remember when Terry went with her to the Hope Center and he went and talked to the pastor and he accepted Christ as a Savior. That was absolutely a prerequisite for Allie. I also remember, I'm sure, the talks that Allie had with Terry about what covenant meant. And, you know, marriage is a covenant. Death do you part. And Terry, you've really had to live that out. And you've been a faithful husband. And I've seen what a caregiver and what a loving husband you've been. And you really did have to live out the death do you part. Good for you. But it was so important for Allie she wanted everyone to understand how important covenant was in marriage. That although her wedding, those of you who might have been here, was a red carpet gala event, which is so much fun and so Allie, she made sure that Pastor John, who did her service, had a real nugget in there about covenant right in the middle of everything. So faith was so important to Allie. And when we got this diagnosis, you know, Allie, she listened and she goes, okay, I was afraid that's what it was. She took it very matter-of-factly. And I told Allie, you know, every doctor's saying that you're incurable, but that's one man's opinion, really. I mean, I know he's schooled, but he really knows this much about everything there is to know about health. There are a lot of other ways to go, and he doesn't know what God knows. And I said, so let's just keep believing and keep praying and, you know, keep looking for other answers and keep, you know, asking God for answers. And we're really only interested in what God has to say, because God doesn't have opinions. God has truth. And until God says that he's done and ready to take you home, I said, let's stand and believe that you're going to be healed. Would you agree with that? And she said, absolutely. Absolutely. So I would always tell Allie, I said, this is such a joyful time for me. I mean, people would come and say, oh, May, how are you holding up? And I said, you know, I'm having a great time because this is a season of life that God has chosen for me, that I can be so close to my daughter like I've never been close before, and we're having a faith adventure. And God has done so many little miracles. Yes, as it says here, you may have lost the battle, baby, but you won the war. But there were a lot of little things that God did. And I don't want to take up too much of your time telling you those too many things, but one thing I want to say that he did, and Allie's going to speak to you in a video in just a few minutes from her hospital bed a little over a week ago. We had made plans 3 weeks before this happened, when Allie's labs and Allie's CAT scans still looked pretty good. And people in Tijuana, Mexico said, yes, we still think we can help her with treatments that won't hurt her liver. The problem was her liver was compromised. So any Western treatment depends on chemo, and chemo hurts the liver. So they would say she was, you know, beyond hope, because they had nothing but chemo that would hurt her liver. So I was looking for alternatives, and we were planning to leave for Mexico that Sunday, a week ago Sunday, when I went and picked her up, and she was so weak, she couldn't stand up. We had to put her in the wheelchair. Her legs were swollen. I knew that meant a sign of liver failure. She was throwing up blood. There was no way we were getting on the airplane. And I said, let's take her to Vanderbilt right now. We did, and the doctors told her, and four doctors told me, and I'm so glad Pastor John was there with us through this whole time, that she had maybe a day to live. They didn't expect her to live the night. This was a week ago Sunday. And they said, what do you want to do? What do you want us to do for her? And I said, well, I want you to stop the bleeding, you know, she'd already lost 2 pints of blood. And they said, well, we don't think this is going to work, but we're going to, you know, put some platelets and red blood cells in there and some vitamin K and some blood clotting units, and we'll just try. But we don't think it's going to work. And I said, well, I appreciate you trying. One thing I didn't know is a lot of Super Bowl parties were stopped for at least a few minutes to pray for Allie for the bleeding to stop. Thank God for Facebook. Facebook can be a good tool. And I also found out later that 2 churches had heard about Allie's bleeding and stopped in the middle of their service to pray for Allie and for the bleeding to stop. And with 6 hours had passed, the bleeding had stopped. And her blood was normal. Normal. And she wasn't healed ultimately, but that's a miracle right there. That is a miracle right there. And so Allie, you know, she came back, she was feeling pretty good, and the doctor just, she was in critical care, and they just opened up the unit and said, you know, they usually say 2 people at a time, but Allie, you can have as many people in as you want. So Allie began to text her friends, and this is so Allie. She said, well, the doctors have just given me a few hours or days to live, so if you'd like to come and see me and support me, now would be a really good time. That was so Allie, and she was texting herself, you know. And so my daughter Erica, who's, again, so creative, not only with music like you hear here. By the way, you know, when we saw Allie's sewing abilities, I got her sewing lessons. When we saw Erica's singing abilities, we got her singing lessons, and both paid off. So as parents, watch for those tendencies that your children have that you want to bless them in. But anyway, Erica got out her flip video camera and she said to Allie, what do you want to say to people, Allie? And I really thought Allie would say, I love my friends, thank you for supporting me, you know, whatever. But I want you to see this video of Allie and what she said. But I wanted to give you that background of where she was, given hours to live, when she did this video. Can we play the video?
I have been given bad news, but through God all things are possible. I believe that with all my heart. He said that I have a perforated colon, and there's just nothing you can do about that. But God is not nothing. And nobody you trust with. If you can bring a dead man buried for days to life, you can do the same thing. So I just pray for your prayers that the word cancer hasn't scared until now. But barely scares me now.
What do you have to tell them about your faith?
My faith? I don't know. This is a chance, I guess, I get to prove my faith. I don't know if that notices.
I don't either. You want to tell them that you love them very much?
I love everybody who sees this very much. And I just, I don't know, see on this help, whichever tried this.
Love you!
Love you!
That's some strong faith. I don't know if you could understand everything she said, but one thing she said is, cancer has never scared me, and it barely scares me now. And she said, I have strong faith, and here's my chance to prove it. And then she said, so I'll see you. If I don't see you here, I'll see you on the other side. She had no fear. She had true faith. Because faith is the absence of fear. Is that not right? Faith is the absence of fear. And that happened on Sunday night. She had tons of friends come and visit her Sunday night, all day Monday, all day Tuesday. Finally, Wednesday, in the middle of a snowstorm, the ambulance, they finally decided to put her in hospice. And she was spent 2 hours in the ambulance going to hospice. And I could barely get there. In fact, the roads were so bad, my husband said, you can't drive. And I put out a call on Facebook, and I said, please, somebody get me to hospice. And Casey and Ken Brown came in their four-wheel drive XL to come and take me very slowly to Madison to get to hospice, because I was going to spend that night with my daughter. And this is the other thing that happened that we believe is a miracle. It was Tuesday night. Again, we're continuing to pray for healing. And I get a call from a man that I didn't know who he was, but he explained that he was married to a gal named Melissa Andrus, who was a friend of Allie and Erica's in their youth group at another church. And she had since married this man, and they were living in Pensacola, involved in the Brownsville church, where the Brownsville revival had happened for years. And they were, they felt like they needed to come and pray for Allie, that if they did, that God had healing for Allie. So they were leaving the next day, and I said, you're going to run into snow, that's Wednesday. And they said, we don't care. And so that was the catalyst for me to call, to handpick people that I wanted in the room to be praying for Allie's healing and to be doing praise and worship for Allie at that time. And even in the middle of the snow, that couple didn't make it that night, but we still had a room full of praise and worshipers and just prayer warriors that were there around Allie's bed that night on Wednesday night. And Allie asked if she could be set up in a chair. As weak as she was, she wanted to set up so she'd have a better chance of singing. And she would mouth the words of the songs. And she was so weak, her husband had to hold up her head. But that was a beautiful time then. And then we heard that the couple was coming the next day around noon. So again, I gathered everybody to be there around noon. And I want Pastor Mark, who was one of the people I asked to be there, to come and share about what happened in that room on Thursday afternoon. Thank you, Mark.
Yeah, I'd gotten the call from May, and we showed up at the room, and I met Trey from Florida, and he introduced himself, and he proceeded to say that that morning he had been spending some time in prayer, and the Lord had told him that grace was going to heal Allie. And he just kept hearing that over and over again. Grace was going to heal Allie. And he just felt the Lord leading him around the backside of the hotel where he was. And as he made it around the backside of the hotel, this is what he saw in the snow. Grace. And as he came, we all gathered together and we were praying for a miracle, and we had gathered and we were worshiping. I tell you, the presence of God was so obvious. It was beautiful. The faith that was in this room was amazing. It was amazing how strong it was. And as we just continued to praise God and just call out to Him over the course of the next couple hours, when she started, it was obvious that she was kind of declining a little bit. Jimmy Seitz ended up putting a phone call out to John to invite John and make sure that Adam as well as Terry were right there by their side. And we just continue to call out to God. Well, May had mentioned to Allie and just said, your daddy's going to come. And he's on his way. Well, later on, as John was getting closer, Allie was lipping the words, Daddy. And May ended up telling her, your dad is parking the car. He's going to be up here in just a few moments. And a few moments later, John came up there. Terry was by Allie, and John went up there and just started saying how much he loved her and that she didn't have to fight anymore, that she could just go. And he blessed her, and she went to be with Jesus. She took one more breath and went to be with the Lord. The amazing thing to me is I don't think I've ever been part of a situation where I've seen so much faith in one room. Because immediately the prayers went out, just thanking the Lord for being so faithful and thanking the Lord that now Allie is with Jesus. Saying, Lord, we just praise you so much because to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And Allie is whole and she is healed and his grace saved her. And as I was just humbled to be right there in the room and see all of this taking place. And then just to see May and embrace John and just tell him how blessed they were to be here, that this was a gift to be here when she went to be with Jesus. And after that, you know, I was just pondering all of it, taking in the whole situation. And it's amazing to me how when you end up looking at death, it causes you to reflect to the point, and it really teaches you how to live, is what it does. Is it teaches you how to live. And I started reflecting on the passage in Scripture in Ecclesiastes 7:2. It is better to go to a house of mourning than to go to a house of feasting, for death is the destiny of every man. The living should take this to heart. And I tell you, I ended up leaving that room and just driving in my car, just talking to God, spending more time talking to God and just thanking him for his faithfulness, longing to make sure that if I was ever in a situation like that, I want that kind of faith. I want that. I tell you, I ended up calling May the very next day, and I just said, May, I got to tell you, I don't know that I've ever run across a person, man or woman, with your kind of strength. I was in awe. I was inspired. And it's the kind of faith that only Jesus can bring. And I ended up coming back to the office, and I remembered I was going through the book, going through just a random book earlier that day before I ever went to the hospital. And as I went through the book, I remember running across a passage in Scripture. And it was this. It's Jesus' words in John chapter 12, where it says, I tell you the truth, unless a kernel of wheat is planted in the soil and dies, it remains alone. But its death will produce many new kernels, a plentiful harvest of new lives. And as I shared that with John, he began to tell me, he says, you know, any fool can crack open an apple and see how many seeds are in it. But nobody knows how many apples each seed will produce. It's infinite, and only God knows that. And the amazing thing to me is that right here, Allie's spirit has been planted in us, and we have been impacted by this family. And I just want to thank you so much for being able to be part.
Tonight, in a few brief comments, I want to honor this incredible family. Terry, love you. You have heard a story of faith. And I'm here to tell you, we can all have beliefs. But when you stare death and you're told you only have hours to live, it's somewhere in a place that is completely uncommon to our human experience. You see peace, roll over someone so profoundly that they begin to take care of the people around them rather than falling apart. When you see the strength of John and May and Terry, it's not because they are any different than anybody else in this room that hasn't experienced loss, but that Scripture says that God gives us a peace that transcends understanding because it has nothing to do with what's happening around us. And it said it guards our heart and our mind in Christ Jesus. And May is up here able to share so poised because she has a hope that Allie spoke when she was there going, I don't know exactly what's going to happen, but if I don't see you here, I will see you on the other side. Paul said the same thing. Paul said, I don't know whether I'm going to be alive or dead tomorrow, but I know this. Whether alive or dead, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So whether I'm gone, which is better by far, or whether I get to be here to encourage you, just know that we all stand in faith. You know, we prayed for a miracle. Man alive, we prayed for a miracle for hours and days and weeks. We prayed for a miracle. And I'm reminded of the story of David. Many of you, whether you've been to church, you know, at all in your life, almost everybody knows David killed a giant, right? You know, David was called by God because of his heart. He becomes the greatest king in all of Israel's history. David saw miracle after miracle after miracle in his life. The giant was just a one of many miracles in his life. But what many people don't realize is that David lost a child. And when we read of his life, when his child got sick, it said that David went to the temple and would not leave the temple. He laid in sackcloth and ashes and he prayed day and night that God would heal his child. It said that he refused food, he wouldn't bathe. All he did was pray for one more miracle in a long line of miracles that had happened throughout his life. The servants on the outside became nervous because the child continued to get worse. And eventually the child passes away. The servants begin to mutter among themselves. They begin to say, what in the world is going to happen? If David acted like this while his child was sick, what in the world is he going to do when he finds out that his child is gone? And he overheard them speaking out there, and he finally asked, is my son gone? And they said, yes, master, your son is gone. And Scripture says that David got up from the floor of the temple, went to his palace, took a bath, asked them to bring him clean clothes and to bring food for him to eat. What he did was so unnatural that the servants, it says, begin to question, we don't understand. Finally, they just walk up and they go, David, we don't understand what you were doing. While your child was sick, you wailed and you mourned, you refused food, you laid in sackcloth and ashes, and would not let anyone comfort you. And now that your son is gone, you stand up, take a bath, put on clean clothes, and order dinner? And David said these words. He said, I know my God, that he is merciful and he is faithful. And David said, I prayed because I know God is a miracle working God. And I wanted one more. I wanted this one to add to a long list of miracles in my life, basically. And then he said these words. He goes, but even though my child is not going to come back and see me, I'm going to go see my son. And that's the reason that we could go on. That's the reason we pray for that miracle, because I know my God, and I know that he is a miracle-working God, and I've seen it in multiple areas. If you talk to John and May about their lives, about the book, about their healed marriage, about over and over, they go, we've seen the miracle of God so many times, so many God stories. And they, like David, wanted one more. But what they all knew, and the reason that you see in their lives a strength rather than being all torn up and falling apart, is because, as Ali said, as King David said, as if you talk to John or to May, they would say, or Terry, Even though Allie is not going to return to us right now, we are going to go see Allie. And that is the message that they asked me to speak to this crowd tonight. Because as we read these words, Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, if he dies, will live. So do not let your hearts be troubled. For if you trust in God, trust also in me, Christ your Savior. For in my Father's house there are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you, and I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me so that you may be where I am. Because we know that if this earthly tent that we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven built not by human hands. And our Savior Christ Jesus has destroyed death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. That is the hope. In fact, the hope was so strong that when Jesus got around people who had passed away, he refused to say they were dead. He kept saying they'd fallen asleep. He did it with Lazarus, and the disciples had no clue what he was talking about. They said, he's sleeping, he's getting better, sure, he'll be fine. And said, finally, Jesus had to plainly say to them, no, Lazarus is gone. When he got to Jairus' daughter, he looked at her, and he said, the girl's not dead, she's just asleep. And they thought he was crazy or wanted to kill him, because you're not supposed to say that at a funeral, by the way. I don't know if you know that. But what Jesus understood was there's a huge difference between when this body no longer has breath and being dead. Death is about being separated from the presence of God. And when Allie breathed her last, she didn't leave the presence of God. She stepped into the presence of God and was more alive than she's ever been. We wanted her healed, but Scripture says now every tear is wiped away from her eye. There's no more sickness, no more disease, no more mourning. The old order is passed away and everything has become new. The message that Allie wanted me to speak, and I will conclude with this, and that the family asked me to speak is this. I'm going to give it in the words of 1 Thessalonians 4:13. Brothers, we do not want you to be ignorant about those who have fallen asleep, exactly what Jesus said, or to grieve like the rest of men who have no hope. For we know that Jesus died and rose again, and so we know that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's own word, we tell you that we who are still alive and left till the coming of the Lord will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel and the trumpet call of God. And those who have passed on in Christ will rise first. And after that, we who are still alive and left till the coming of the Lord will be caught up to meet with them and the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage each other with these words. We will always be with the Lord. If we have done what Allie did at the end of that service, if we've asked him to come into our life. Death is about being separated from the presence of God. And he said, anyone that calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. So John and the family ask us to provide a room, which is right through those doors out in the other side, that when the service is completed, if you've never done that, but that is something that you desire to do, to make Jesus the Lord of your life, as Allie did, and find a peace and a presence of God that you see manifested in these lives, that is crazy radical because it doesn't have anything to do with what has happened around them. It has to do with something that is supernatural within them, and you want that. You'll have an opportunity to meet some people over there and pray. And we encourage you that if you've never done that, and your heart has been touched by Allie's life, if you've seen a reality in this family, that you can know that for yourself, and they will be over there. And speaking of one more very strong individual that is just experiencing the power of God is Erica, and she's going to share about the CD that you're going to pick up at the end of the service, and then we will be concluded in just one moment. Erica.
Well, Allie was a theater person, and this is a packed house with standing room only, so she would approve. I'm going to make this quick. I know you guys have been here a long time. This is the only time I'll get to do this. So, Allie and I were not always close. When we were younger, as my mom said, she was the bad one and I was the good one. And I was really good. I was just really snobby. That's the deal. I was like, oh my gosh, you're going to get a spanking. You know, I was like that a lot. And it took me a long time to realize that you don't make friends that way very well. But what changed, I think it was either my junior or senior year of high school, I was trying so hard to fit in because it had always been difficult for my family. We went through some poverty and we went through Allie and I were always different. We were creative and we went to schools where that wasn't really accepted. And I learned how to play along with the sort of popular kids just to kind of coast through and be like on the verge of being cool, but just enough to not get made fun of, you know. But you know how any little thing can tilt that balance and then you're a dork again. You know how that goes. So I was trying to ride that wave and try to be kind of cool and kind of be with the cool kids. And even though I was really creative and really didn't want to be like them, and Allie just did not care. She was herself and she was weird and she liked, you know, all the stuff that Aisha talked about. She was just, she would dress how she wanted to dress. She would say what she wanted to say. She was still loyal to the death. But she would get me made fun of a lot in school, which isn't cool in high school because, you know, I'm trying as hard as I can to be accepted. And they're like, oh my gosh, did you see what your sister was wearing? She's such a dork. Like, or say stupid things about her that she's so weird. I just don't get her. She doesn't wear Abercrombie clothes. What's wrong with her? You know, stuff like that. And so at first I was like, yeah, I know, she's so lame, right? You know, just like little sisters are lame. And something hit me, and I know now it had to be God. And I just had a revelation one day that was like, you're going to be in high school for like 4 kind of stupid years. And you're going to have your sister for the rest of your or her life. And you need to get over yourself. And appreciate her while you have a chance. And I just made the decision from that point on, no matter how much we got made fun of, no matter what people thought, no matter what, that she was going to be my best friend. And I started encouraging her, and I started picking out things in her that I thought were cool. And I started like writing her notes of encouragement, and at school I started sticking up for her and just saying, you know what, actually you're the dork and my sister's cool, you know. And Allie just responded to that, and we became so close after that, and just have continued, and just had continued to be up until the very last day. And it made such a huge difference. So as an encouragement to you guys who have sisters, brothers, mothers, fathers, any kind of family member, friend, where there's a rift or any kind of similar situation, just take that to heart and love them while you can, because you're not always going to be able to. As far as the CD, as Allie and I got closer and closer, I went and did mission work in Africa for half of a year in 2001. And while I was gone, Allie learned how to play guitar, and she was very, very excited about that. And so when we came home, she was like, I can play guitar now. And I've always loved to sing, and she's always loved to sing. So we'd spend hours in her bedroom singing worship songs. We would just be like, what do we want to do? Watch TV? No, let's go in your bedroom and sing worship songs until midnight, you know? And we would just sing and sing and sing and do harmonies. And it got to the point where I was about to go to college, which was just MTSU, but I knew I wouldn't be home very often. And I was like, man, I'm going to miss this so much. This has just been so wonderful, just us singing and doing this worship. It's like my favorite thing to do now. And so we decided, well, why don't we just record it? Why don't we just do a recording of us doing what we do so that when we're not together, we can listen to it and remember each other. And at that time, it was going to college. And who knew how special that would come to be. And so, you know, I thought about maybe just giving everybody a copy of the Hope songs. All of you guys have downloaded it and been so supportive. But I thought, you know, it's not the best recording. Allie had just learned how to play guitar. It was 10 years ago. But there's something so special about it. And it shows the sisterly bond that we had. And the most special thing about it is that right before we recorded it, my grandmother passed away. And we had a chance right before she died to sing I Can Only Imagine to her while she was very sick. And I know that song has become very cliche, and some people are like, oh, I can't listen to that one more time. But it's still a powerful song. And so we decided to record it and sing it on our record, you know. And Allie's singing lead. And so at a lot of funerals, people sing I Can Only Imagine. But at this memorial celebration, Allie, with me on harmonies, will be singing I Can Only Imagine for you. Thank you.
For Terry, for John, and for May, and for Adam, and for Erica. So I just encourage you, over the next couple of days, weeks, months, let them hear just your encouragement, your love for them as a family. And we know that God is already doing a miracle work within them, so let's just close in prayer. Father, we thank you that your word says that you bind up the brokenhearted and you heal their wounds. That, Lord, you do walk with us, that you know our needs even before we ask. And yet, Lord, you said that when we ask, we will receive, and that our joy will be returned to us. So, Father, we just acknowledge your presence. Thank you for your watch care in each person in exactly the way that they need it. And, Father, we continue to pray, Lord, for Terry's dad and also for his grandmother, Lord, as they are continuing to look for your strength and your watch care and your wholeness and your healing over their lives. Father, we thank you for this evening, that it was honoring, and that, Lord, Allie doesn't imagine anymore. She's living it and experiencing it. And all of heaven rejoices. And Lord, we look for her watch care and her prayers now that she's joined that great cloud of witnesses. Father, lead us, empower us, heal us, make us new. In Jesus' name, amen. Again, as you encourage one another and you're dismissed, if you want to have someone pray with you tonight, they'll be through those doors into the room directly across the hall there. Lord bless. Have an awesome, awesome evening with the family.